Good morning, YouTube. Today, we're going to measure a bunch of parts on the 355 to verify if they're good or bad.
So are you recording all of the nefarious activities?
If you're new to the channel, my name is Dan, and we are at the Howard. And today, we're going to continue working on this 355 engine that we got torn apart, laying here on the floor. Josh is on his way here. He's going to help us out because, well, yeah, I don't really know what I'm doing here. So this is going to be relying on him. But before we get into it, real quick, if you want to support the channel, please like, share, and subscribe. We do appreciate when you guys can do that. It helps us out tremendously. Also, go visit normalguysupercar.com. There you can buy parts and services for your car. So check it out and use the code NGS10. It hooks you up with 10% off almost everything we sell. And finally, if there's something that's not on the website and you'd like us to get it for you, send us an email, sales@normalguysupercar.com, and we'll do our best to find it and hook you up with a great price.
Okay, YouTube. Josh is here. Hi, Josh.
Hello, YouTube.
Josh is going to help us get our learn on today.
We're going to do some maths.
Ooh.
How to suck at maths with 5 easy tips.
That's scary.
Ooh, maths.
I mean, you know, I got a math minor, but I still suck at it.
Well, yeah, it's a minor. It's not a major.
Right, exactly. That's right.
I'm lucky I can do addition.
Why do you think I became a car mechanic? If I was good at math, I'd be a hedge fund broker making real money.
Killing it in meme stocks, right? Holding diamond hands on Robinhood.
So we're going to do a basic evaluation. There's some things we will and won't do due to necessity, machine process, all of that. It wasn't a blown up engine. So like when we took it apart, we were able to inspect the bottom end bearings, rod bearings, all of that. And that gives us a pretty good indication of machine fit and whatnot. But we're gonna go through a few of the other critical components and just do a basic eval on the head and the block to see how much further we need to go with this bad boy today. So where do you want to start, Dan? Block or head?
I mean, I don't care. I was trying to think of some sort of smart-ass remark and I couldn't think of
it. Are you more of an ass man or a head man?
I mean, I guess we should start with the ass.
Okay, all right.
Let's talk about this big old block.
Yeah, so core measurements, right, are flatness and squareness of the deck, which we're not going to worry about because we don't have a machine surface to work off from here. Ideally, we'd have a ground bar that we'd run on the main journal on a flat table like a mill table, right? And then you can run indicators across the top of the block surfaces and make sure that they're square and parallel. So we're not really going to worry about that. And again, this isn't a blown up engine. We didn't have any head gasket leakage. There's no signs of head gasket leakage. So we can trust that generally speaking, the deck surface is square and true and flat, right? It's a pretty safe assumption. The mains, right? We don't have machine tools here to check the alignment of the bore for the crankshaft mains. So we can't check that. But again, when we pulled everything apart, we noticed that the main bearings all had even wear.
Yeah,
and there was no copper or, you know, uneven edges, right? So we're talking about how bearings have a triple layer, right?
Yep.
There'll be a nickel, a lead, a copper, and then you've got the actual steel base. So as would be typical, you still see some of the nickel in the center of the bearing cap, and then it's polished away on the edges, which is normal for an engine like this due to the crankshaft flexing, and the oil is fed through the center of the bearing. So it'll just lightly, you know, kiss, if you will, you know, those outer edges of the main bearings and take that first layer of nickel away.
Makes
after 80,000 miles like this engine has on it. That's pretty normal. But there's no points where you can see the edges being worn down more on one side than the other or anything like that indicating that there's misalignment of the crank or the block. So we can assume that it's in good shape and let the machine shop worry about if they want to do a line hone check and machine the caps and all of that sort of thing. That's outside of what we're set up to do here. And this is kind of typical in my experience with Ferrari blocks like this. They're pretty good quality. You know, they got high quality parts in them. The well designed, the metallurgy is pretty good quality. And really these cars aren't beat on very hard. It's not like a super sport Camaro, you know, where every kid in every small town in America is trying to learn how to be the next John Force, you know, nitro funny car driver.
And at the finish, oh, a huge explosion and fire for John Force.
Most of the guys who own these cars are pretty respectful of them, you know, and cognizant that rebuilding this motor costs.
We do know that this one was tracked a lot.
Was it?
Yeah.
Nice. Good. Then we have a few things to check, right?
Yeah.
So a couple of things that we need to think about. if you notice, right, you've got a steel liner pressed into the block, right, and there's a ledge here, okay?
Yep.
So this ledge comes above the aluminum deck, so we call that liner protrusion.
Okay, yeah, yeah, you can feel it.
Yep. So the reason why you have liner protrusion is for the head gasket sealing, okay? You've got the metal firing ring.
You actually intentionally want that.
You want this because what you may not realize is the aluminum, even though it expands at a slower rate than steel,
it expands more.
Yep. So if we were to put dial indicators here and then heat this block up, you'll find that the aluminum will actually rise up above this first step of the liner and start to match the height of this raised step here.
No kidding.
Yep. So you need that protrusion so that way when everything is hot and expands, you don't lose your clamp on your combustion ring in your head gasket, which would obviously cause catastrophic failure.
Yeah, that'd be bad.
So in old engines, we're talking 60s, 70s, maybe even some of the 80s stuff, you know, that's been poorly cared for and poorly maintained. You can have issues where the aluminum seat down, machined down inside of the block may be worn away and the liner will actually drop down and recede into the block. Okay. So now you start to lose head gasket sealing.
Wow.
You know, early castings obviously weren't as high a quality as they are now, so it's a more common issue in old engines than these engines. But still, you know, for the sake of thoroughness, because kind of we want to do an evaluation on whether or not we have to do machine work with the block or whether we can just clean it up and reassemble it with all fresh wear parts, bearings,
yeah, we got our
and gaskets.
Bearings, so these are the main, those are the mains, and then these are for the rods.
Yep, a lot of times we're redoing these motors at like 20,000 miles.
Right, and they're really in good shape.
Yeah, they're in super nice shape. So most of the time, you know, no machine work's needed on the bottom end. You do guides and a valve job on the heads and put it back together with new head gaskets and, you know, basically do a, like we did on Timmy's car, you know, it turns into a cam belt plus instead of a full tear down, you know? I do that quite a lot on these because they're such good quality bottom ends. The next thing we're gonna look at is the walls of the cylinders, okay?
Yep.
You have everybody, you know, is aware of honing and whatnot, right?
Yeah.
So there's two different factors related to a hone, right? One is the degree angle of the actual crosshatch, which are actual basically sanding marks, right? Impressions in the cylinder walls. And then you also have the depth. Of course, we're going to understand that the angle is going to be correct, so we don't need to check that because this was a factory-built motor, but we want to take a look at the depth of the hone pattern as much as we can to determine how, you know, worn away it is, because the piston ring manufacturers and Ferrari actually give a specification on how coarse this hone pattern is supposed to be, so that way you get a proper bedding into the rings.
Interesting.
Because the rings will actually, you know, you get the hone pattern and then you get the surface of the ring essentially. So the biggest part of wearing the motor in is bedding the piston ring into the hone pattern of the cylinder wall. Because some of that
is it kind of like a clutch and a flywheel?
It's more like, think about like a gasket sealing surface.
Okay.
Right? On a soft paper gasket, you want some roughness, right? To get a, you know, a good engagement. Right? Whereas if you have, I don't know, two metal parts going together, you know, the more of a mirror finish,
the more they bond together.
Exactly. But if you were to put a paper gasket in between, the rougher, you know, to a reasonable degree, the rougher it is, it allows that paper to be absorbed by both surfaces.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So similar idea here. You know, you've got a smooth piston ring face, and then you've got a coarse hone pattern on the cylinder wall. Well, that hone pattern is going to get worn down a little bit, but also that ring needs to lock into that a little bit. That's one of the reasons why there's a crosshatch, we call it, right? Because the piston ring is actually going to rotate during the process of the engine running. The piston ring doesn't sit static. It will rotate. And so the crosshatch pattern helps control the ring rotation, and the depth of the sanding marks or the hone will determine how deep the ring locks in. We want to know how rough this hone pattern is, right? How much purchase we have essentially, because if there's not enough, our new rings won't seat and then we'll have a smoky motor with even worse compression and leak down than before. Yeah. And these are Nicosil coated steel liners.
Whoa.
So you can't rehone these.
Okay? Oh, okay. So if they're bad, you just
we just replace them. So I have a surface profileometer that we will try and see if it will measure the roughness.
Huh.
So all of these finishes surfaces are calculated in what's called roughness average. And there's a few other nomenclatures for it, but here in the US we typically just use roughness average. And so I got a little tool with a cool little finger on it that will go over the surface and it'll measure, you know, the peaks and valleys over a certain distance and calculate that and tell us, you know, how rough it is for, you know, a given, you know, per inch, basically how many peaks and valleys per inch there are. And so there's a value both for the piston ring manufacturer and the Ferrari factory manuals on how rough we want that. Same thing with the top of the block. You know, we want a specific finish, like we're talking about on the block and the head, for good gasket sealing, so we can measure those surfaces once they're clean and determine whether or not, you know, the surface is adequate to seal a new head gasket. I can already tell you from experience, it'll be fine. For the composite, like on Timmy's car, you know, we just scuffed it with razor blades and Scotch-Brite and brake clean, put the gasket on, do it all the time, and it works fine. These L-ring composite gaskets accept a RA finish up to 100, and that's 100 micro inches, which is not very smooth. And they actually have a minimum smoothness, which is about 40 RA. So if this were done to a nicer than 40 RA,
it's too smooth
and the gasket will have trouble sealing. So we've got a pretty wide berth.
So 40 to 100 basically.
Whereas the piston ring range would be like 10 to 16.
Ooh, okay, way tighter.
And much smoother. So we've got some very different values. So that's why the old, you know, it looks good and, you know, it feels good kind of method is not necessarily.
Well, you can't tell a difference between 10 and 16. What'd you say it was?
Micro inches.
Give me a break.
I wouldn't even begin to know how to.
Sorry, your fingernail ain't going to cut it.
No. The closest we get to a fingernail is if we see scratches, like we saw some vertical scratches in one or some of these cylinders.
One of the cylinders had a little.
So the closest we get to finger. Fingering the motor and that being it remotely accurate is if we see vertical scratches in the cylinders. If you drag your fingernail across it and you can catch it, then it's deep enough to be a problem. And if you can't feel it, then, you know, it's purely visual. Because again, we're talking, you know, this is Nicosil coated liners and we're talking a couple thousandths of an inch worth of material. And since it's basically a metallic reinforced clear coat, right, the visual impact of a scratch is going to be significant, right? It doesn't take much of a scratch on a thick coat of clear for it to look like a deep scratch, you know, just like on the paint job, you know, you just wipe dirt off and now it looks all scratched, but the reality of it is you could hardly ever measure those scratches.
It's just super tiny.
Yes, more of the refraction of light than the actual depth of it. So if you can't feel the scratch, then it's probably not going to affect your piston ring sealing, because the honing pattern's probably more coarse than that. But, you know, that's
still need to check.
Yeah, you still want to check and make sure there's not something super obvious. So that's the essence of what we're thinking about when we're looking at the block and what we're going to do today and make sure that the block is or is not in good condition and what we need to do to fix it.
Sweet.
Any questions, Dan?
No, thank you, teacher.
Okay.